In this task, we look a bit further into the capabilities of Bash for programming. And we know already that the Bash is used to interact with our operating system. The Bash allows us to execute individual programs. So let's have a look. I'm here on my command line interface, where I can type a command such as ls, which is a program that is executed. So sometimes what you want to do is you want, for example, count how many files are there in a directory. So how could you do that? Well, we could do it manually. We see here we have two files, right? But what do you do if you have 10,000 files? Certainly you can automatize this process, which is what is possible with Bash. One way of doing it is to say, I take the output of ls, okay, store it in a file. Let's call it ls.out. Now when I do ls, I see this file. And let's see what is inside this file. Well, it's just our listing what files exist. You see there's the file itself is also listed because it's being created when I run the ls command. So now we can run another command called wc, which is word count, on this file again, which counts how many lines are in there. And we see that there are 3 lines, 3 words and 29 characters in the file ls.out. So this is a way of counting how many files are in our directory, and we used the bigger S symbol here to indicate the bash that the output of this command shall be stored in this file. There's also a way to feed in input, which is when you create it in the opposite direction. So here I take ls.out and feed this input as a standard input into the program wc. I deleted the file already. So let's recreate it. Now you see it produces the same output, with the only difference is that it doesn't know anything anymore about the file name. So when I run wc on a file, it outputs the file name as well. Well, here it just took the standard input. But the output of our program is the same, 3 lines. Okay, so I used this and this symbol, the big S and smaller N S symbols, to redirect output. And in Linux, there are basically 3 channels that produce output. There's the standard input channel, the standard output channel, and a standard error channel. Okay, so each of the input, you feed in input, the output and the error channels, they produce outputs of the program. If the program has an error, then the error is handled on this additional channel. So we've now figured a way out to count the number of files in the directory, but this is really cumbersome because we had to create this ls.out file. Luckily, there is a way in Bash to chain programs together to feed in the output of one program directly into the input of another program. That is with the pipe symbol. So when I write ls pipe, what it means is that the output of this program gets fed in into another program that I can count put in here. So I can do ls pipe wc, and I have fed in the output of ls into the program wc. Here's also an illustration on the sheet how it works. So we have the program ls, which goes into this pipe, which is a unidirectional stream of data. So the data that I feed that comes from this program gets fed into the other program on the right hand side. So now you can basically follow these steps that are put here on the sheet to run the different steps, but you might already have understood the usefulness of this approach. For example, let me go here on my terminal again and count, for example, the number of entries that I have in my history. Remember, the history in the bash prints you the recently performed commands, and I could pipe this output into a program called tail, which gives you the last 10 lines. If I do this, I see here now my last 10 commands that I have inputted. So I see here ls, and then I have done, you know, all these commands. So this is pretty useful to document what I have been doing, and being able to reproduce my actions. It's a very important part of programming. So you could also, you know, use another program like crab. And with the crab program, what does it do? We saw it on our exercise, I suppose. It searches in a line for a string, here for the string history, and only outputs lines that contain this string. So I could, if I run this, I get all my previous commands that contain the string history. So again, very useful to figure out what's going on.